A study of this chapter is likely to enable the reader to understand the psychological forces that motivate an individual to behave in a particular manner in his social environment. Furthermore, the purpose of this chapter has been to enable the reader to understand the fundamentals of social psychology and also help him to understand better his social environment and its impact on him and his behavior. A society is more lasting and permanent than man. The values, traditions, and norms of society may change according to situations from time to time, but the permanent nature of society has to be accepted. Every society, in order to maintain its permanence, tries to keep some control over its members. This control is both written and unwritten. Laws and religion may be accepted up to some extent as written controls, but mores, fashions, traditions, customs and folkways, etc., come under unwritten controls. The importance and bindings of both written and unwritten controls are equal or similar. If these controls or restrictions are not observed, permanence of society will be endangered and its disintegration will start. In this chapter, we shall study the forms of such social controls as rituals, mores, religion, myths and legends, law, taboos, folkways, customs and traditions. We shall study about rituals. A ritual is a universally accepted practice which everyone knows and follows on some special occasions. For example, lighting the earthen deeps or candles on Deepavali, embracing each other on Holi or Eid, Christmas, tying of the holy thread by sisters on brothers' wrists on Raksha Bandhan, and feasting Brahmins during Shraddha, etc., are instances of certain rituals. Let us study about mores. Some mores are prevalent in a society. The feelings of public welfare are associated with them. All members of the society have to observe them. Those who violate them are punished. Mores pass on from one generation to the other. We have to be polite and courteous in our behavior towards elders. We are condemned and snubbed if we do otherwise. We have also to be polite and cautious in our costumes and have to respect social mores. If we walk naked, it will be against the social mores. People generally believe that mores are useful for all, since our ancestors have developed them after sufficient experiences. Let us study about folkways. The difference between mores and folkways is that no punishment is awarded to those who go against the folkways. It depends on one's sweet will to accept or reject folkways. He is only laughed at sarcastically or made fun of it if he violates some folkways. The society does not show its resentment because it is mainly related to an individual's personal life. The society at large is not influenced by it. The instances of folkways may be such as putting a necktie, a special kind of headdress on the head, keeping the buttons of coat in the front, wearing shoes, daily brushing the teeth or taking bath, etc. If a man does not follow any of these foibles, the society is not affected and therefore there is no provision of any punishment. Let us study about myths and legends. Myths are generally imaginary. They contain descriptions of some troublesome past incidents. This description is not wholly correct. These help in solving some problems, so they are useful and important for the society. In each society and culture, some particular myths and legends are found. These may relate to some great men, leader, ideal institution, or some recognized tradition or value. Legends contain more truth than myths, but these two have not escaped the man's imaginative influence. In other words, they also contain some element of imagination. As they are passed on from one generation to the other, some changes are wrought in their nature. Legends too prove useful to society. Legends teaches morality and values and help develop faith in ourselves. Many rituals of society are based on them. For instance, observing the fast among Hindus on various occasions and among Muslims during Muharram and Eid are based on myths and legends. In difficult situations of life, we draw inspirations from myths and legends. There are many myths prevailing about great men like Maharana Pratap, Shivaji, Swami Dayanand, Swami Ramakrishna Paramahamsa, Shankaracharya, Mahatma Gandhi, Abraham Lincoln, Confucius, Tolstoy, etc. We draw inspiration and courage from these myths in difficult moments of life. In legends, we find the description of valiant and courageous deeds of many warriors. From myths, we develop faith in our religion, culture, and civilization, and legends present before us such ideals which help and guide us. Let us study about laws. Customs bound by rules are laws. Laws are found in well-organized societies. The state makes laws. The society which has no government has no laws. In such a society, anarchy is the order of the day. In modern age, laws are framed by legislative assemblies and parliament. The society is assured protection through laws, and one's rights and duties are laid down. Those who violate laws are prosecuted and awarded punishment by the state. The law also determines the nature of punishment for different types of crimes. Dissatisfaction spreads in the society when the government hastily enacts a law and the society opposes that law. This opposition is expressed through movements, newspapers, magazines, meetings and processions. The democratic government of India needed the enactment of many new laws since independence. The new laws were bitterly opposed to. when any law goes against the spirit of any custom or tradition, it is opposed. The Hindu Divorce Act is such an example. Neglecting customs and traditions while enacting a law is regarded as bad. Let us study about taboos. Taboos are found in every society and are very powerful. This is a type of restriction based on one's internal fear. Taboos impose restrictions on certain behaviors and practices. Fearful consequences are apprehended in violating a taboo. Consequently, one accepts a taboo as a law, and generally one does not dare to violate it. For instance, taboos relating to taking of food and sex may be cited. Taboos exist in many Brahmin families. Some of them are supposed not to take food touched by others or to eat meat and drink alcohol. People are supposed not to enter into marriage relations with near relatives. This taboo is found in many civilized societies. Taboos are greatly helpful in maintaining social controls and discipline because no one dares to violate them. Society generally considers taboos good. Consequently, those who go against them are bitterly criticized and often boycotted by others. Taboos exercise control over one's undisciplined behavior and stop him from treading an evil path. Taboos are harmful only in that condition when they stray far from the reality. Now let us study about customs. Customs are those social standards which continue from generation to generation and are helpful in determining good and bad behavior. Thus, customs exercise control over one's behavior and the society approves of or disapproves his conduct. A custom is in this way a technique for exercising social control. A custom is a kind of social habit. Once it is accorded recognition, it is very difficult to remove it. A man thinks that customs were introduced by his ancestors and are being transferred from one generation to the other since times immemorial. We should not think that customs are unchangeable. In fact, they change, but changes occur within the recognition of the society. For instance, some decades back, Indian women used to hide their face by drawing forward a part of their apron or sari over it, but gradually, when they were given equal rights and freedom, they gave up this custom. People, while going on journey in earlier days, thought of auspicious and inauspicious women because in those days the means of transportation were not safe. Let us study about traditions. Tradition indicates social heredity. Within its purview come universally accepted recognitions, views, thoughts, conversational manners or art of eloquence, course of conduct, laws, mores, folkways, customs, stories, myths, legends, religion, fashion and taboos, etc. As we have seen earlier, all of them are passed from one generation to the other. Evidently, traditions are transferable from one generation to the another. Traditions provide a sense of security to an individual. The individual knows that if he follows the traditions, no one will dare raise eyebrows against him. That is why he fears to accept such new ideas which go against the prevailing traditions. An individual learns traditions during childhood and behaves accordingly. Traditions give an individual the feeling and consciousness of the group. These help one's self-development. The tradition of a society which has an ancient or very old culture is very firm and deep-rooted. The members of a society having firm and deep-rooted traditions are more developed. There are many methods of enforcing group norms. In every group, there are social controls which operate to correct the errors in socialization. These controls force an individual to conform to social norm and to the designated role. The parents and teachers and others appeal to the individual in many ways to conform to the ways of the group. They may appeal to his prejudice, to his pride in and desire for status within the group. They may punish him by withdrawing privileges or even affection by isolating him or excommunicating him. We find that different kinds of social incentives may be used to make the individual conform to the group norms. Further, concern for what the others think and say, concern for what the others will do to us, operate as powerful agents to bring about modifications in our behavior. In other words, when we have internalized the social norms, the control will be from within. But this is no less a social product than social controls from without. For example, a boy may be very honest at home, but he has some desires which he satisfies by becoming a member of a gang in the neighborhood. As a member of this gang, he may destroy some property because he does not want his friends to think of him as a coward. Thus, a boy in that situation may have a conflict in himself between the social norms of his family and the social norms of his friends. Let us study about group morale. We find that the group organization may affect the behavior of an individual in a particular manner that is designated as a group morale. Morale signifies the general level of regard that the members have with respect to the group. It implies that the members have self-control, self-confidence, and a sense of discipline as members of the given group. This depends upon the importance which an individual attaches to his membership of the group. When the membership is greatly valued, and then the group will be able to enforce its norms. If the members generally feel themselves strongly identified with one another, if each feels that all the others are contributing to the best of their abilities to the group activity, and if there is general agreement that the forms of group action are desirable and profitable, then morale is high. If there is dissension, bickering and other forms of interpersonal conflict between group members. If there is doubt concerning the validity of the group norms and uncertainty over the future of the group, membership identification is weak and a state of demoralization exists. When there is demoralization in a group, we find that cliques will be formed composed of small subgroups with their own sub leaders who may be antagonistic to each other and to the organization as a whole. It is quite possible that a group may be well disciplined and unified when it is working for other causes. Studies in the World War have shown that battalions which are rated as extremely high in morale while in training camps disintegrated on the battlefield. Morale thus is a complicated phenomenon which involves the goal situation also. Many social psychologists stress the following five factors as being essential to good group morale. Presence of a positive goal for the group to achieve, a feeling of togetherness in the members of the group, awareness of a danger to a group, a conviction that conditions may be imposed so that the goals can be reached, and finally, an awareness of advancements towards the group goals. In passing, we may observe that leaders like Gandhi and Nehru have been able in India in recent years to keep up the group morale by making the individuals feel that there is a positive goal, namely political freedom in the olden days and the advancement of social and economic freedom in the recent years, and making the individuals, the youth as well as the citizens, feel that the country as a whole is advancing towards the attainment of these worthwhile goals. We may now consider briefly some of the factors which influence the group morale. We know that in general, success improves and adversity lowers the morale of the group. The members of a prosperous family will work together with enthusiasm and faith when the family is going up the socio-economic scale. Similarly, the members of a club will be very enthusiastic when the club is growing. It is a familiar fact that the army which is successful in a battle enters the next engagement with greater zeal than the army which is on the losing side. But we should not conclude that high morale and success are invariably associated. High morale may lead to success, but success may also lead to demoralization. Just as an individual loses his head to demoralization of his success, similarly, a family or an army may become demoralized and dissipate its resources. On the other hand, a family which has met with adversity may struggle hard to cope with its difficulties. There is a great illustration of the way in which when the British retreated to Dunkirk, their morale went up and they were able to meet the vast German armies later on. Among these factors, the traditions of the group and the character of its leadership are very important. Let us study about leadership. Leadership also counts considerably in influencing the group morale. In groups with long traditions, leadership may not count as much as in groups which are newly formed. The leader has a greater part to play in keeping the group morale in success as well as when the group fails. In preventing demoralization, the leader plays as important a part as traditions. He can put faith in the members of the group in the outcome of their efforts. Let us study about participation. Participation in the activities of a group with high morale is stimulating as well as gratifying to the members of the group. On the other hand, participation in activities of a demoralized group is discouraging as well as disheartening. The individuals will put their highest efforts, they will conform to the group norms with willingness and enthusiasm. They respond to the group controls and subordinate their interests to the requirements of the group membership. But when there is demoralization in the group, most of the members will tend to rebel against the authority of the group as well as its leaders. They will tend to violate group norms and put their personal interests of the group. Thus, we find that the significance of social control depends not only on the nature of the group norms, but also on the state of the group morale. Let us come to the conclusion. A society is more lasting and permanent than men. Every society, in order to maintain its permanence, tries to keep some control over its members. If these controls are not observed, permanence of society will be endangered and its disintegration will start. In this chapter, we have studied many social controls as rituals, mores, myths and legends, laws, taboos, folkways, customs and traditions. We have also studied about various methods of enforcing group norms, group morale and the character of informal social control.